which is still being dealt with us. The US presidential election is scheduled to hold on the 8th of November, and it is the 58th of such elections.
Well, the 22nd Amendment of the United States Constitution prevents the incumbent president, Barack Obama, from contesting for the third term.
So new sets of candidates will be contesting to determine the 45th president and 48th vice president of the United States.
Well, we'll be discussing the U.S. presidential election process, and we are joined by the Chargé d'Affaires of the U.S. Embassy in Abuja, Nigeria, David J. Young. You're welcome.
Good morning.
David Young previously has served in many capacities, Deputy Chief of Mission U.S. Embassy Lusaka between 2013 to 2016. He's a Foreign Service Officer for 23 years, served as Deputy Director of the Office of U.S. Special Envoy for Sudan and South Sudan between 2011 and 2013. He was also Acting Deputy Chief of Mission in Khartoum, Sudan from April to May 2012, and he has held other several positions in the Office of Secretary of State and Foreign Mission in Hanoi, Panama, Burma, Oman, and Bahrain. He graduated from the University of Missouri with a bachelor's degree in journalism, so he's one of us. Diploma in the Communication Studies from the Trinity College, Dublin, Ireland. Master of Divinity degree in Ethics and Master of Arts in International Relations from Boston University. Thank you so much, David Young, for joining us.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure. Good morning.
Good morning to you. Like we said earlier, the elections are on the 8th of November, a matter of days away. As a diplomatic mission in Nigeria, what are your plans for the elections?
Sure. Well, I think all American citizens are going to be expectantly watching the election. Most of us who are overseas have had a chance to vote already in terms of casting our absentee ballots. And we at the mission are going to be hosting a watch party here in town. It's by invitation only. But it's going to be an opportunity to get together to watch the returns come in the middle of the night, Wednesday morning, from about 2 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the morning will be the crucial time.
Interesting. He's been closely followed, not just in the United States, but around the world. How does this campaign season compare to other campaign election season, presidential election seasons?
Well, I think as we've all seen, this is a very vigorously contested election. And there are, at times, the rhetoric has been very boisterous and emotion-filled. But I think it's really a clear choice for the American people to have two different visions of government, and that's what democracy is all about.
Let's look at the process for voting for American citizens residing in Nigeria, for instance. What's that process like?
Sure. For an American residing here in Nigeria, you've needed to request an absentee ballot in advance. And so, for example, my wife and I have already gotten our absentee ballots and filed them. The embassy was able to collect them and send them to Washington, D.C., or to the individual states where people vote. But at this point, it's gotten so close to the election that if people were going to vote, they would actually have to go to their districts in the United States to cast their votes.
All right. This early voting system, election is actually on the 8th, but some person, you talked about absentee voters earlier, some early voting has already taken place. How really does it work? I mean, I'm looking at it from the context of Nigeria, where even election is taking place everywhere is going to be shut down. The embassies would close and other offices would close as well. How does it work?
Sure. Well, individual states have the different 50 states have different procedures for how they carry out their early voting. But several of the key states, for example, Florida, North Carolina, Colorado, have already started their voting. And so it means that over a period of 2 weeks, people can go to the voting center in their hometown and they can cast a ballot. And that can happen 2 weeks in advance or a week in advance. It makes it more convenient for people. And frankly, it helps boost the turnout because in the United States, you're not required to vote. People are strongly encouraged to vote, but it's not a legal requirement to vote. So by having this longer period in play, it encourages people to come out to vote and not have to stand in such long lines on election day.
And Mr. Young, like my colleague said earlier, the American elections is widely followed across the world, including in Nigeria. as well. And the question is, does Nigeria and Africa generally matter when it comes to the U.S. Presidential elections?
Well, I think there's two ways to answer that question. And on the one hand, you have a number of voters like myself who care a great deal about foreign policy. And for us, the direction that our president is going to take us in terms of leadership in the world, on peace and security issues, on international economic policy, on human rights and development, climate change, those are crucial things that go into the calculus for a number of people as we decide who we want to vote for and who we want to be our leader for the next 4 years. Now, for people like me, you know, what our policy is towards Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa's most important country, Nigeria, is crucial to our vote, and it impacts, you know, how we think about issues. At the same time, if you think about voters here in Nigeria, for example, oftentimes people vote on their pocketbook issues. You know, how do they feel about the jobs environment, the economy? Is the economy growing? Are there new opportunities being created? Do people feel better off today than they did 4 years ago? So I think for a lot of those voters, probably they don't really focus on foreign policy as much as they do domestic affairs.
Mm. Talking about foreign policy, do you anticipate any significant change in terms of foreign policy of the U.S. to Nigeria and perhaps all the African countries as part of the outcomes of these elections?
Yeah, no, I think that there's a fundamental continuity. There's a bipartisan consensus in terms of our policy towards Africa, and I think towards Nigeria in particular. We have very strong interests here and a great partnership between the American government and the Nigerian government and the Nigerian people. And I think the interests that we have in terms of working together on peace and security issues, on economic growth and prosperity, on health diplomacy, and the other things, humanitarian assistance that we work together on, those kinds of cooperation will continue. So I think that our relationship is solid, and the relationship, the partnership going forward will continue.
Now, a lot of Sub-Saharan African countries model their democracy around what is in the United States of America. Let's look at what are the origins of the U.S. Primary system in which political parties select candidates to represent them during elections.
Sure. We have a kind of a unique system in many ways. Our system of the Electoral College, where voters actually don't directly elect the president, but they vote for electors or representatives coming out of their states that then are the ones who formally cast the votes for who's elected president. That makes a proportional representation system so that a big state, for example, California, has 55 electoral votes. A small state that doesn't have much population, like Wyoming, only has 3 electoral votes. And so those votes are allocated from the most populous to the least populous. And then it's a winner-take-all system in all, to get into the fine points, all but 2 states. So for example, if the voters in California elect one candidate by 50 votes, that candidate gets all 55 of the electoral votes of California. And you need 270 total electoral votes to win, which is the majority. So it's this unique system where it makes the United States presidential election basically 50 different contests across the 50 states and, frankly, the District of Columbia. So you have to compete to win in different states. And that way, when you hear about the U.S. election, there's so much focus on a handful of states. For example, Florida, Colorado, North Carolina, Ohio. And those are the states, maybe 6 or 8 of them,
that will really... Battleground states.
Those are the battleground states. And that's where the election's going to be fought out. I'll make a prediction for your viewers.
Okay.
I think there are going to be 4 really key, crucial electoral states to watch. Florida is definitely one of them. Mm. North Carolina this year will be very important. Colorado and Nevada. And my prediction is, and I don't take a side on who's going to win, because as an American diplomat, I have to be nonpartisan.
Sure.
But I think that if Donald Trump would win all 4 of those states, he would be elected president based on the votes. Mm. If Hillary Clinton wins one of those 4 states, she would probably be elected president because of the way the voting is going in other states.
That's interesting, because we're finding, you know, based on what we're seeing from the polls, very close contest. How close has this been in previous elections?
Yeah.
Because I still remember the election that brought in Barack Obama in 2008, just how close it was between him and McCain. And do you compare that to this one? And it raises anxiety levels for the voters and others monitoring the elections outside the U.S. as well.
Yeah, no, I think this could very well be a very, very close election. It's coming right down to the end. It's like a sprint to the end. I think in some ways the closest election we've had in modern times was in 2000 when George W. Bush beat Al Gore. And you had an anomaly.
Well, that issue in Florida where the votes had to be subjected to
individual counting one by one, hand ballots. And they had the little term that they talked about, hanging chads, which is on a paper ballot, when you punch the hole in the ballot, there's a little piece of paper that hangs on the ballot, and that little chad, if it didn't fall off, they had to decide, was that a vote for or not a vote for? So they literally had lawyers looking at those ballots one by one over a period of about 3 weeks. The thing that was unique in many ways about the 2000 election is that in terms of the popular vote, Al Gore got more votes across the country than George W. Bush did. But George W. Bush won the crucial state of Florida, which had over 20 electoral votes, and that put him just over the top in the Electoral College. So you had a different winner of the popular vote and a different winner of the electoral vote.
How does it affect the voters themselves? When you talk about the Electoral College and popular votes, we have a direct system here in Nigeria where, you know, popular votes count. How does it compare? Do the voters feel somehow, to some extent, however insignificant, disenfranchised, that they can't directly vote for their president? Yes, go through an electoral college.
I think that's a really good insight, because I do think there are people in some states who feel like it's almost as if their vote counts less than those in some states. Mm-hmm. My brother, he lives in California, and I know that California is a blue state, so it's a state in presidential politics that will almost always vote Democrat. So he knows that his vote is important, but in many ways it's not crucial, because we basically know those 55 electoral votes for California will go for the Democrat Hillary Clinton. Likewise, Texas is a red state, and almost certainly it will go for Donald Trump and the Republicans.
Mm. Now, if you look at the voting pattern, most of the time, depending on voter outcome, we want to look at possibly policy changes regarding, you've already stated earlier about your concerns because of what you do. Most people are concerned about how issues affect them immediately and vote based on that. Do you foresee policy changes concerning Nigeria-US relations, anyhow this election pans out?
You know, I think there'll be fundamental continuity in U.S.-Nigeria relations. I think we will see that. When a new president comes in, certainly for those of us who work at embassies around the world, work as diplomats, there are new focuses that they bring. And, for example, Secretary Kerry, as Secretary of State, has brought a new focus on environmental policy, climate change. President Obama has, again, focused on climate change, global development, the fight against global terrorism. But I think those kind of, the continuity of those fundamental interests that we have and the partnership that we have with Nigeria will continue.
We've heard so much about electoral commissions in Nigeria. We have the Independent National Electoral Commission, which is a central focus anytime we're planning for election. But we've hardly heard of anything about the U.S. Electoral Commission. Who takes charge of administration and counting and sorting out of the votes? Who manages the electoral process in the U.S.?
It's interesting because in our federal system, where there's a division of powers between the federal government, national government, and the state governments, there really is a lot of autonomy devolved to the states. So we have a national federal electoral commission that sets broad guidelines for how the vote will be conducted. But each of the 50 states and the District of Columbia have their own individual procedures for casting votes and counting votes. Some of them do an electronic system. For example, my home state of Virginia, you go into a voting booth, you pull the curtain, and then you have an electronic screen where you push your buttons, and then it will say, confirm, you want to vote for all these people, you hit confirm and you vote. In other states, they still have paper ballots, you know, so it's an interesting patchwork system where, you know, we have federal oversight over the election, and of course all the results go together, but there are individual state systems that are conducted in different ways. It's a bit of a patchwork.
And here you are in Nigeria, where some people still believe the pattern of voting with ballot papers is archaic and not following modern trends, and yet America still has other states who vote with ballot. Are there any disadvantages with that particular process of voting through ballot papers?
Well, I think, you know, there's pros and cons. I think in some ways, just for me as a citizen, just my personal opinion, I think in some ways going to a more uniform system would probably be better, and I think that's probably where the U.S. is going to evolve to. So, you know, we could perhaps learn from Nigeria, and that's it. I think that it is a bit of an unusual system that we have such, in some ways, some archaic structures, you know, in certain local communities. But again, you know, having those paper ballots, if, like in Florida, you know, there's a cliffhanger election, which some people are predicting we could have another one in a couple states like Florida this year, you know, then you have those paper ballots that people can take out and go over laboriously as they did in 2000 over a period of about 3 weeks.
Do you also have a system where American citizens outside American soil can vote?
Right, yeah, as long as you're a U.S. citizen, you're 18 years old or older, that you're registered in your local constituency, you have to be registered in a state and have your local you know, registration for a particular election. You can vote, request an absentee ballot, which will be sent to you by one of several means, and then you fill that out and you send that into your state. So my wife and I, we both voted in Virginia, which is one of the crucial states this year.
All right, let me take you back to what body of government is actually in charge of, you know, conducting the election in each state. Clarify that again for us. Yes, we know that there's a federal system, and then each state is autonomous in its own ways. Does that mean each state has its own body to conduct election?
Yeah, there are state bodies in each state that there's a head of, usually, often in a state, the position is called Secretary of State, which is different than our Foreign Minister, which is the U.S. Secretary of State, who is currently John Kerry. But there is an official within each state, say Ohio or North Carolina or Florida, that is in charge of conducting the election and overseeing the election in that particular state.
So just the office of the Secretary of State.
Exactly, within the state.
So eventually the votes...